Jesus taught that in the last days, many of his professed followers would think that they belonged to his kingdom and were Christians, when actually they belonged to the kingdom of Satan and were eagerly and diligently serving under his kingdom of darkness. How can this be? Do you know the Bible test that determines whether you belong to the kingdom of light or the kingdom of darkness? In just a moment, we'll see.
Welcome to Steps to Life with Dr. John Grossbaugh.
Sabbath rest is a promise between God and His children.
Bible prophecy tells us that we are living in the last days of this earth's history before Jesus' second coming. Today's program will help you prepare for these coming events. Stay tuned.
Thanks for joining us. Before we look again at the difference, the fundamental difference between Christ's kingdom and Satan's kingdom, let's pray and ask the Lord to help us understand what we're going to read from His holy book. Father in heaven, we thank you for the Bible and for Bible prophecy that explains to us the meaning of history and also the meaning of the present and what is going to happen in the very near future as an overwhelming surprise to most of the inhabitants of this world. And we pray that you'll help us to understand what we read now so that we will be found on the right side at the end of the great controversy. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Today, many people are not concerned with matters of eternal importance. Many are living their lives with no thought of what is truly important. And many live with a mere surface knowledge of Christ, thinking that this is enough for salvation. Is it? Today's free book is entitled, The Only Way to Be Saved. To receive your free copy, simply call 1-800-THE-TRUTH. Call now.
The Bible says that when God sent His Son into the world, that He was born of a woman under the law. You can read that in Galatians, the 4th chapter. Since Christ was born under the law, it was necessary for Him to keep every particular of the law. Now, here's what the law says in Leviticus, the 12th chapter, when a woman bore a male child. This is what it says in Leviticus 12. If a woman has conceived and borne a male child, then she shall be unclean 7 days, as in the days of her customary impurity she shall be unclean, and on the 8th day the flesh of his foreskin shall be circumcised. She shall then continue in the blood of her purification 33 days, so forth. At the end of that time, a sacrifice was to be offered. And so if you take 7 days plus 33 days, that would give you about 40 days. And so in harmony with what the law said, about 40 days after Jesus was born, he was brought to the temple and the sacrifice was brought also. Here's what it says about it in Luke, the 2nd chapter. It says, "Now when the days of her purification, according to the law of Moses, were completed," that would be when Jesus was about 40 days old, "they brought him to Jerusalem to present him to the Lord. As it is written in the law of the Lord, every male who opens the womb shall be called holy to the Lord, and to offer a sacrifice according to what is said in the law of the Lord, a pair of turtle doves or 2 young pigeons. That's in Luke, the 2nd chapter. If you look back in Leviticus, in the law of Moses, you will find that actually they brought a lamb for a sacrifice. But if you were poor, you were too poor to bring a lamb, then you could bring 2 turtle doves or pigeons. We know from this account then that Mary and Joseph were poor. Christ conformed to every particular of the law. He had been subjected already to the rite of circumcision. You read that in Luke, the 2nd chapter, as a pledge of his obedience to the law. Why was the firstborn child to be dedicated to God? You find that this was a custom, and it was a religious ordinance from the very earliest times. The reason for this was that God had promised to give the firstborn of heaven to save the sinner. And so this gift was to be acknowledged in every household by the consecration of the firstborn son. You can read about that in Exodus 13, verse 2, or in Numbers 3, 13, where the Lord said, "Sanctify unto me all the firstborn, both of man and of beast. It is mine." Now, after the tabernacle service was established, the Lord chose the tribe of Levi in the place of the firstborn of Israel to minister in the sanctuary. However, the firstborn were still regarded as the Lord's and were to be bought back by a ransom, that is, by offering a sacrifice. The scripture says, "And every firstling of an ass thou shalt redeem with a lamb, and if thou wilt not redeem it, then thou shalt break his neck. And all the firstborn of man among thy children shalt thou redeem." You can read that in Exodus 13, 13. So, this redemption, this sacrifice concerning the firstborn son was something that prefigured a greater deliverance. It was a memorial, of course, of the Lord's wonderful deliverance of the children of Israel from Egypt. Because of the rebellion of the Egyptians, all of their firstborn children were killed. But the firstborn of the Israelites were all saved by the blood on the doorpost. That prefigured the deliverance to be wrought out by the only begotten Son of God. The blood that the Israelites sprinkled on the doorpost, that saved the firstborn of Israel. But the blood of Christ has the power to save every single person in the world that is willing to come under His sovereignty. And so, with that in mind, we begin to understand the significance of the presentation of Christ, the firstborn of Mary, in the temple 40 days after He was born. But the priest did not understand. He did not see through the veil. He didn't understand the mystery of what was happening, because this was a common scene. There were firstborn children, infants, brought all the time 40 days after their birth, and they were enrolled in the roll of the firstborn of Israel. And so the priest had been doing this and receiving the redemption money day after day after day. It was to become a commonplace thing to him. He went through the ceremony, did his official work. When he took the child Jesus in his arms, he did not know that he was holding the majesty of heaven who had come to this earth to save humanity from sin and death. He handed the child back to his mother and he inscrolled the name. In English, it would be the name Jesus. In Hebrew, Yeshua. He inscribed the name in the roll of the firstborn. But he didn't think. He didn't think that this is the majesty of heaven, the King of glory. He didn't know that this was the one whom Moses had written about and said, "A prophet shall the Lord your God raise up to you of your brethren, like to me. Him you shall hear in all things, whatever he shall say to you." Acts 3:22. The priest did not think that this babe was he whose glory Moses had asked permission to see. But there was one greater than Moses in the priest's arms that day. And when he enrolled that name in the roll of the firstborn, he was enrolling the name of one who was the foundation of the entire Jewish economy and religious service. And that name was to be the death warrant of the typical system, the symbolic system, because the system of types and sacrifices was becoming old, and the type was just about to reach the antitype. The shadow was almost to reach the substance. The sacrifice of animals, which was a type of the sacrifice of Christ, that was going to be done away when the true sacrifice was offered. Now at this time, when Jesus came, the Shekinah had already departed from the sanctuary. But in the child of Bethlehem, there was veiled the glory before which the angels of heaven worship. This unconscious babe in the arms of the priest was the promised seed. The promised seed that God had promised to Adam and Eve in the Garden of Eden. to whom the first altar at Eden's gate pointed. This was the one called in Genesis the Shiloh, that is the peace giver. This is the one who declared himself to Moses in Exodus 3 and said, when Moses said, "Who shall I say has sent me to the children of Israel?" He said, "Say, I am sent you to them." I am, of course, is the name that denotes the eternal presence. Jesus claimed in John 8 that he was the I am. This is the one that was in the pillar of cloud and the pillar of fire that accompanied the children of Israel all through their wilderness wanderings. This is the one whom prophets had foretold for thousands of years. This is the one that is described in the Old Testament as the desire of all nations, as the root and offspring of David, as the bright and morning star. This is the one that is the only hope for a fallen humanity. This one is the one who is going to pay the ransom price for the sins of the whole world. This is the one who would become the true priest, the high priest over the house of God, as you read in Hebrews 10:21. This is the one that would have an unchangeable priesthood, as you read in Hebrews 7:24. This is the one who would become an intercessor for the whole world at the right hand of the majesty on high, as you read in Hebrews 1:3. But in those days as today, spiritual things are spiritually discerned. And the priest looked upon this child as he would look upon any other child. He didn't see anything unusual. But there were a few people who understood spiritual things. There were a few people who were living a holy life in contact with the God of heaven. One of them was a man by the name of Simeon, and he entered the temple, and he sees a family who's presenting their firstborn son to the priest. And he understands the warnings and instruction of the Holy Spirit speaking to him in his mind. He's deeply impressed that this infant who is being presented to the Lord is the consolation of Israel, the one that he has longed to see. And we read what happened here in Luke, the second chapter. It says, "Behold, there was a man in Jerusalem whose name was Simeon, and this man was just and devout, waiting for the consolation of Israel, and the Holy Spirit was upon him. And it had been revealed to him by the Holy Spirit that he would not see death before he had seen the Lord's Christ. So he came by the Spirit into the temple, and when the parents brought in the child Jesus to do for him according to the custom of the law, he," that is Simeon, "took him up in his arms and blessed God and said, 'Lord, now you are letting your servant depart in peace, according to your word, for my eyes have seen your salvation, which you have prepared before the face of all peoples, a light to bring revelation to the Gentiles and the glory of your people Israel.'" So, this man sees what is really happening. And he continues to say what is going to happen. He says, "Then Simeon blessed them and said to Mary his mother, 'Behold, this child is destined for the fall and rising of many in Israel, and for a sign which will be spoken against. Yes, a sword will pierce through your own soul also, that the thoughts of many hearts may be revealed.'" You see, the people who were the leaders in Israel, the people who held positions as rulers and priests in Israel, they had before then the precious utterances of prophecy too, but they were not walking in the way of the Lord, and their eyes were not open to see the significance of what was happening right in front of them. This is the way it is still today. There are events taking place in the world today upon which the attention of all heaven is centered, but they are undiscerned by mankind. Their very occurrence is unnoticed, even by religious leaders and worshipers in the house of God. Men acknowledge the Christ in history, but they turn away from the living Christ. You read in Matthew 25, verses 40 and 46, when Jesus will return, it says, "The king will answer and say to them, Assuredly I say to you, inasmuch as you did it to one of the least of these, my brethren, you did it to me." The way you treat other human beings is accounted in the books of heaven as the way you treat the Lord Jesus. In verse 45, he says to those that are lost, "Then he will answer them, Assuredly I say to you, inasmuch as you did not do it to one of the least of these, you did not do it to me." Christ, in his word still today, is calling for self-denial and self-sacrifice, not abuse of the body, but self-denial for the good of others. He is speaking to men by those who are poor and suffering and pleading for relief. He is speaking to mankind today in the righteous cause that involves poverty and toil and reproach. But he is no more readily received today than he was 1800 years ago. The angel said that his coming was going to be tidings of joy to all people. And God was seeking, through the words of Simeon, to correct the narrow Jewish conception of the Messiah's work. God wanted men to see that the Messiah was sent to be not only the deliverer of Israel, but the redeemer of the world. Now, Mary had looked forward to the coming of the Messiah as an event in which the Christ would sit on David's throne. But she didn't see yet the baptism of suffering by which it must be won. And so through Simeon, God in mercy gave her an inkling there's going to be some suffering involved in gaining the kingdom. He said to Mary, "A sword shall pierce your own soul also." In tender mercy, God gives to the mother of Jesus a glimpse in advance of the anguish that she is going to suffer for his sake. The anguish she had already begun to bear as the leaders of Israel rejected the Christ from the moment of his birth. They rejected the message of the shepherds, and they would soon reject the message of the wise men. Simeon said, "This child is set for the fall and rising again of many in Israel, a sign that shall be spoken against." Have you ever thought through the words of Jesus and realize what he said in Matthew 21, that you cannot rise unless you fall first? What does that mean? We'll look at that next.
Sometimes studying the Bible on your own without any help or guideline to follow can be a little difficult. And after confusion and frustration set in, we all too often turn to other things. If this sounds like you, you're not alone. The Steps to Life Bible Correspondence School is just the answer. Call 1-800-THE-TRUTH and ask for your free Bible Correspondence Starter Pack.
I really enjoy being able to study at home. I'm a new Christian, and I definitely knew I needed some guidance.
Simply review each lesson and answer the questions.
These studies were great. It just seemed like the Bible opened up for me.
Then send the completed lesson back to us in the envelope provided.
These studies were very professional. They didn't take a lot of time, and I really appreciated that.
A Bible teacher will then look over each lesson and send them back to you with the next set of studies. It's that simple and totally free. Call Steps to Life Television at 1-800-THE-TRUTH.
I'm so glad I called.
Welcome back. We must fall before we can rise. We must fall upon the rock and be broken before we can be uplifted in Christ. Or if we explain it in common language, self must be dethroned. Pride must be humbled if we would know the glory of the spiritual kingdom. This is the way Jesus explained it in Matthew 21, 42 to 44. "Did you never read in the scriptures, 'The stone which the builders rejected has become the chief cornerstone. This was the Lord's doing, and it is marvelous in our eyes. Therefore I say to you, the kingdom of God will be taken from you and given to a nation bearing the fruits of it. And whoever falls on this stone will be broken, but on whomever it falls, it will grind him to powder. Jesus said, if you fall on this stone, he is the chief cornerstone. If you fall on this stone, you'll be all broken up. Self will be humbled. Pride must be destroyed. Self must be dethroned. That's a hard experience. It's like falling and being all broken up. But Jesus said, if you don't fall, eventually the stone will fall on you. You'll be ground to powder. The Jews were not willing to accept the honor that is reached through humiliation. And as a result, they would not receive their Redeemer. To them, he was a sign that was spoken against. Simeon said, the thoughts of many hearts will be revealed. The thoughts of how many hearts? The thought of all heart. The thought of every heart. The thoughts of God the Father toward the human race. And also the thoughts of Satan the devil. Satan had represented God as a selfish and oppressive person, claiming all and giving nothing. Satan had claimed that God required service of his creatures for his own glory, and that he made no sacrifice for their good. But the gift of Christ reveals the lie that the devil told. It reveals the Father's heart. It shows that the thoughts of the God of heaven toward us are thoughts of peace and not of evil, as you read in Jeremiah 29:11. And the gift of Jesus declares to the human race that while God's hatred of sin is as strong as death, his love of the sinner is stronger than death. And so, having undertaken our redemption, God the Father will spare nothing, however dear, which is necessary to the completion of his work. He has already given his only begotten Son. No truth essential to our salvation is withheld. No miracle of mercy is neglected. No divine agency is left unemployed. The whole treasury of heaven is opened up. The riches of the universe have been collected, and the resources of infinite power have been made available to anyone who chooses to follow Christ. He gives them all into the hands of Christ and says, all these are for man. Use these gifts to convince him that there is no love in earth or heaven that is greater than mine, and his greatest happiness will be found in serving me. At the cross of Calvary, love and selfishness stood face to face. It was their crowning manifestation. You see, when you study the life of Christ, you find that he lived only to bless and comfort and help humanity. And in putting him to death, Satan manifested the malignity of his hatred against God. The devil showed to the entire universe that the real purpose of his rebellion was to dethrone God and to destroy him through whom the love of God was manifested to the human race. So, by the life and by the death of Christ, the thoughts of men also are brought to view, because from the manger to the cross, the life of Jesus was a call to self-surrender, to fellowship in suffering. It unveiled the purposes of men. The worshipers of self belong to Satan's kingdom. In their attitude toward Christ, all would show which side they stood on. And thus, every human being passes judgment on himself. In the day of final judgment, every soul that is lost will understand the nature of his own rejection of the truth, because the cross will be presented, and its real bearing will be seen by every mind that has been blinded by transgression. And human apostasy will then appear in its heinous character. Men will see what their choice has really been. Every question of truth and error will have been decided. And God will stand clear of the blame for the existence or continuance of sin in the universe. It will be demonstrated that God's law did not cause sin, that there was no defect in God's government, there was no cause for disaffection. When the thoughts of all hearts are revealed, here is what will be said. You read it in Revelation, the 15th chapter, verses 3 and 4. It says, they sing the song of Moses, the servant of God, and the song of the Lamb, saying, great and marvelous are your works, Lord God Almighty. Just and true are your ways, O King of the saints. Who shall not fear you, O Lord, and glorify your name? For you alone are holy. For all nations shall come and worship before you, for your judgments have been manifested. We're rapidly, friend, approaching that time. We're approaching the time when everybody's going to have to face the consequence of the life that he lived in this world. Did he choose to fall on the rock and be broken and follow in the path of Jesus Christ, in the path of self-denial, becoming a good and faithful servant of God and humanity? Or was his life dedicated to exalting himself at the expense of whatever happens to somebody else? That's the principle of Satan's kingdom. Which kingdom do you belong to? Right now, which spiritual leader are you following? Jesus said, if anyone will come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. The one who chooses to serve me and follow me where I am, there he will be. You find that in John the 12th chapter, verses 25 and 26. Jesus said, he who loves his life will lose it, and he who hates his life in this world will keep it for eternal life. If anyone serves me, let him follow me. And where I am, there my servant will be also. If anyone serves me, him my Father will honor. How is it in your life, friend? Have you chosen to follow Jesus, not just by profession, but are you actually following in the path of self-denial and self-sacrifice? Not abuse of the body, but self-denial and self-sacrifice for the good of others. Serving God faithfully as a good and faithful servant, and being also a servant of your fellow man. Which side, which spiritual leader are you following? Are you really part of the kingdom of light? Does your life demonstrate it? Or does your life demonstrate that you're really part of the kingdom of darkness while you claim to be a Christian? Which is it, friend? Which spiritual leader are you following? Your life demonstrates the truth of whether your profession is valid, of whether it is real or not. One day, both the loyal and the disloyal are going to acknowledge this, because the Lord says the day is coming when every knee is going to bow to me. They're going to acknowledge the justice of the divine government. But it'll be too late. If you've been disloyal, it'll be too late then to have eternal life. Where are you going today?
Today, many people are not concerned with matters of eternal importance. Many are living their lives with no thought of what's truly important, and many live with a mere surface knowledge of Christ, thinking that this is enough for salvation. Is it? Today's free book is entitled, The Only Way to Be Saved. To receive your free copy, call 1-800-THE-TRUTH. That's 1-800-843-8788. What will it mean for those who have lived for themselves and have not prepared for eternity? How can a person make sure that they don't waste probationary time and that they are ready for Jesus' second coming? Today's free book is entitled, The Only Way to Be Saved. To receive your free copy, call 1-800-THE-TRUTH. That's 1-800-843-8788. From all of us here at Steps to Life Ministries, may God richly bless you.
Steps to Life.
We hope you have been as blessed by today's message as we have been in bringing it to you. We encourage you to contact us at Steps to Life Television with any questions or comments you might have.
Check 1-2. Check 1-2.
Don't forget to ask for today's free offer.
Ready in 5.
Steps
4.
To Life Television, a ministry preparing a people for the soon coming of Jesus Christ.
Welcome, friends.
He can change your life.